A turbocharger is a clever device that allows an engine to produce more power. A non-turbocharged engine uses regular uncompressed air and fuel. This works fine, but if you compress air, that is, take air that normally fills a, say, a pint glass and squish it down to a half-pint glass, then inject it into a cylinder, you'll get a bigger bang because there's more oxygen for the fuel to mix with. A bigger bang makes the cylinder move faster, which makes the crankshaft turn faster, which means a bigger smile on your face. So turbochargers use a turbine to compress the air, then feed it into the combustion chamber. Superchargers work in exactly the same way, but the difference is how they're powered. Superchargers power the turbine using mechanical means, for example by a chain attached to a drive shaft. But this robs power from the engine. For example, the Rolls-Royce Merlin engine used on the Spitfire took 150 horsepower from the engine just to power the supercharger. However, by compressing the air, that supercharger gave the engine an additional 400 horsepower. Turbochargers don't rob the engine of any power, instead they cleverly use the engine's exhaust to power the turbine. This gives the engine more overall power, but also means the turbo can only run when you have enough exhaust gases to make it work. That happens when the engine is running fast, meaning you only get turbo boost at high revs. This results in the dreaded turbo lag, that momentary wait you get before putting your foot to the floor and the car taking off like a startled pony. The earliest use of supercharging was by Gottlieb Daimler in 1885. This was a bit of a turnaround, as Daimler had been a big proponent of atmospheric engines while working with Niklaus Otto before Otto's invention of the four-stroke engine. There was no love lost between the two men, although they'd worked together for many years. This probably spurred Daimler on to make a superior engine with his younger partner Wilhelm Maybach. With both Daimler and Otto trying different improvements to perfect the internal combustion engine, it's maybe unsurprising that Daimler thought to attach a gear-driven pump to force air into the engine to increase its efficiency. But in the early days of internal combustion engines for cars, there were much more fruitful avenues to pursue to gain more power than turbocharging. It wasn't until 1905 that Alfred Buchi, just 2 years out of university, would hit upon the idea of using exhaust gases to power the turbine. He was frustrated that a massive two-thirds of the internal combustion engine's energy was lost through exhaust heat. But his turbocharger design was only theoretical, as materials weren't yet available to build a device that could withstand such high revolutions and heat. However, his design laid the groundwork for the way all turbos work today. By 1915, he had a working prototype, but it simply didn't work reliably, and it would take another 10 years until he had a workable solution. The first practical turbocharger would be fitted to diesel marine engines and would boost their efficiency by a colossal 40%. Marine engines were an ideal first use for turbos. They generally ran at slow, constant speeds and used large displacements. All of this reduced the stress on the turbo components, allowing for a reliable system. But turbos wouldn't only be used for ships. It was soon seen that superchargers and turbochargers could be useful in boosting power in aircraft engines. Planes needed as much power as they could get from as light an engine as possible, and early engines didn't produce much power. This led to aluminium engine blocks, radial engines, and other tricks to get as much power from as small a weight as possible. Another reason for turbos was the thinner air at high altitudes. There's even less oxygen, which produces even less power for an engine, so compressing the air is a priority. This is why you don't see those early aircraft flying to high altitudes. The lure of supercharging and turbocharging in aviation led to experiments in turbos in France in 1916 to provide ever more powerful aircraft for the First World War. A year later, tests were also carried out in the US. Instead of trying to test the engine whilst in flight at high altitude, the engineers drove the engine 4,250 metres up the famous Pike's Peak to run high altitude tests there. Once higher quality parts could be produced, aircraft engines started using both superchargers and turbochargers. By the time of the Second World War, it was a necessity to use these on your engine to provide the necessary power to compete in a dogfight or to have a high enough altitude for a bombing raid. Superchargers have been used on sports cars since the 1920s, but with the development of turbochargers in aviation, turbochargers were tried out in vehicles in the 1950s. They offered so much, but were temperamental beasts. No better example of this was the 1952 Indy 500, where Fred Agabashian secured pole position with his turbocharged car, but retired on lap 71 out of 200 with turbocharger failure. With lower revving, higher displacement diesel engines being easier to turbocharge, it was maybe natural that trucks would get turbos first. Volvo would produce one of the first diesel turbocharged engines in 1954 that boosts power from 150 horsepower to 185. The first production car to use a turbo was a version of the 1962 Oldsmobile F85, dubbed the Jetfire. The engine it used was an old friend that keeps cropping up in big car videos, the Rover V8 that was originally created by GM in 1961. So you can now win a pub quiz question in the very unlikely event that this ever comes up. And that time, it was called the Buick 215, and rather fittingly, the turbo allowed the car to get to 215 horsepower and to 60 in less than 10 seconds. But with both the 215 engine and turbocharger being unreliable, the car was short-lived. Just 1 month later, GM introduced the second turbocharged car, the Chevrolet Corvair Monza Spyder. It was powered by the Turbo Air 6 engine, an engine that up until now hadn't been anywhere near a turbo. And once the turbo was installed, they changed the name to the Supercharged Spyder, despite it not actually using a supercharger. This engine and turbo combination proved more reliable, and it was produced throughout the 1960s. Turbos started to become a force to be reckoned with when Bobby Unser won the 1968 Indy 500 in his turbocharged Eagle Offie. It wasn't the fastest car in the race, that belonged to the gas turbine powered Lotus 56s, but it was the most reliable, and after 200 laps and 500 miles, that's what matters. This win signalled that significant performance gains could be made using turbos, and companies rushed to use them. Porsche would win the 1972 Can-Am series with their 917 10K. Just 1 year later, German rival BMW would add a turbo to their iconic 2002. But due to excessive turbo lag and safety concerns, it was withdrawn the following year. But Porsche did manage to tame that turbo beast in 1974 when they introduced the 911 turbo. In fact, it's hard not to think of the name Porsche 911 without adding turbo to the end. Turbos have been an integral part to Porsches and other sports cars ever since. This led a rush to turbocharging engines that reached fever pitch in the 1980s, with almost all manufacturers adding turbos to give their cars a boost, such as the 1984 Ford Escort RS Turbo. Early turbos, like the late 1970s Saab 99, could be unrefined and temperamental, but soon they became a simple and smooth way to give a free boost to the car's output. Turbos first came to Formula 1 in 1977. They soon became the only engine to use, but were banned in 1989. They made a comeback in 2014 as part of Formula 1's drive to focus on fuel efficiency rather than raw power. Turbos have even been used on occasion in motorbikes. The first was the 1978 Kawasaki Z1R TC, but this was one wild machine. The company that made it, the Turbo Cycle Company, took a stock Kawasaki Z1R, boosted its 80 horsepower to 135 horsepower, and made any prospective customer sign a liability waiver. Without a rev limiter, it was easy for the valves to hit the pistons, which would mean a very sick engine very quickly. Throughout the 1980s and 90s, turbos were refined to produce more and more output. Twin turbos would commonly be used, each powering half of the cylinders. This meant smaller turbines that could spin up faster, reducing turbo lag and the forces on the turbine. Some systems would use both a smaller and a larger turbo to reduce turbo lag by relying on the smaller turbo first and then the larger turbo when it's had a chance to spin up. And with the increase in demand for diesel cars, turbo diesels became popular, combining fuel efficiency with good acceleration. Intercoolers were another improvement. All this compressing air results in friction, and friction produces heat. Hot compressed air isn't as dense as cold compressed air and can also lead to engine knock, which can damage engines, so an intercooler takes that hot air and cools it down. Despite the weight these components add, cars were getting ever faster. Lotus's Esprit only used a 2-litre four-cylinder engine, yet by the late 1990s it could output a reputed 500 horsepower that had to be tamed to just 350 to prevent obliterating the gearbox. Nowadays, turbos are just one of the weapons in a car designer's arsenal in the war against not just 0-60 times, but increasingly fuel economy. By 2017, 27% of vehicles sold in the US included a turbo. In Europe, it was a more impressive 67%. Fuel injection has also given cars a major boost, meaning even today's basic econoboxes have more power and better fuel economy than some sports cars from the 1960s. A big thank you to all my patrons for supporting me. To get early advert-free access to new videos or to appear in the credits, please consider supporting me using the Patreon link below from just $1 or 80p a month, and hit that subscribe button to get notified of new videos. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next video.